Morning. Thank you so much for this opportunity, Sona and group. I don't have many new ideas, just one, which is be yourself. So I'm starting with a topic called insanity to innovation. Before I go into that, I'll start with a story. I had a friend once who was making chicken. And as she was cooking, the first thing she did was to remove 1 inch from this side, 1 inch from the other side, and then put the chicken inside the oven to bake. And I asked her, why are you doing that? And she said, I don't know. My mother used to do that. So then I asked her, why don't you find out from your mother why she does that? And she said, okay, I will. And she asked her mother, and her mother said, I don't know. My mother used to do that. Okay. And then so when she went for her vacation to Kerala, I told her, find out from your grandmom, because it was working on my mind. Why should it be like that? And then the grandmother said, in those days, the chicken used to be big and the oven used to be small. So to fit it in, I had no choice but to cut off 1 inch from the front and 1 inch from the back. Okay. And why I'm using this is, it sounds funny. It sounds insane. And that's exactly what I'm trying to start with today, with my favorite quote. Insanity is doing the same things again and again and again, expecting different results. And a purer form of insanity, or the purest form of insanity, leaving things as they are and expecting that they should change. And so that's the insanity I want to talk about today. And I'm going to specifically talk about how this insanity has affected our education system. It's affected the messages that we give our children and also our definitions of success. And it's such an honor to speak just after somebody like Namalwa sir, because we have a similar message, but we're working on two different soils. One, the actual soil, and the other soil right up here. Okay? So, we're working on that. And so, I'm going to start with, you know, the traditional education system or the formal schooling system we have today was designed by the Victorians for an age of mass production. It started right after the Industrial Revolution. So, we have the factory model school, and you know, you have the assembly line. This is really what happens in our schools these days. One or two try and bring in some little bit of creativity here and there. But just look at this. Can you identify with this? Did you go through something like this? Yes? Yes. Some of you, totally or not at all? Yes? We went through this because we were expected to go through a process. And also, even funnier than the assembly line, the child brings in a brain into the factory, which is called the school, and goes out as a finished product. Okay? I know you're laughing, but believe me, that's what we went through. Grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, grade 4, which is like process after process after process. And in the end, what happened? We went out with this huge job in a multinational company to destroy the very resources in our country. Right? Then, even worse than that is our quality control. So every child has to fit the same box. I know you're laughing again, but then see, this is what it's doing. You don't see it in your schools as it is, but when I show it to you like this, you're like, oh my God, this is what it is. If you don't score that 98, 99, you're probably not fit enough to fit into that box there. Right? And believe me, I didn't fit into that box. Okay? And I'm glad I didn't, because it made me think about what more do we need to look at. So, coming to this, this factory model of education is what I'm trying to change. This is the first part. But even worse than that is our cells and bells model of schooling. A prison and the school have the same architectural style and the same way in which they work. Okay? Cells and bells, small rules, rooms, and one person in charge, encouraging discipline. You're supposed to walk in a line. In fact, last year we had somebody who visited our school, considered a very big consultant for schools. She said, teach your children to walk on the left side so that there is no problem in school. Why should they walk on the left side? Children love running. Children love screaming. Why should I control that? Because discipline is not what you need in schools. You need creativity. Yes, in a prison, you need discipline because that's a correctional facility. Do our educational institutions need correction? Maybe at the management level, yes, but not at the level of the teaching. Right, I'm sorry. I know I'm going to be thrown out of here. But anyway, no inputs in decision making. Your cells and bells, the moment the bell rings, you can go to the toilet. You can even go to the toilet only if the bell rings. Right? So that's really how our systems are. And that's why I call it the cells and the bells model. See, look at this. Look at the school corridor there and the prison corridor. Any difference? The school corridor just has an extra bench. That's it. Okay? So, this is the second area that I try to break away from, because the moment you put a child inside a system like that, their ability to think differently, to innovate, becomes limited, because they're not even allowed to speak up when they have something different to say or something more intelligent than the teacher to say. Right? You get what I'm saying? Are you with me? Yes? Can you agree? My next part, the messages we are giving our children. We're all looking at gadgets. I have nothing against interactive apps. The whole point is, an average child today spends a lot of time in front of the computer, in front of the television, etc. We all know the obvious effects that it increases violence. Right from 1962, they've been saying the Bobo doll experiments and things like that, where children beat up other children and all of that. But now, imitating stunts. In fact, now, if there's a soft drink ad, they say, don't imitate this at home. You know, because they're warning you already. Because there have been incidents. But what I would like to talk about are the toxic effects. The difference between a poison and a toxin: the poison kills you instantly. A toxin kills you slowly. Okay? And these are mental toxins. Just think about it, an average mega serial. You have a vamp who's the mother-in-law, and then this really subdued daughter-in-law. So you're already twisting your child's brain there, saying, you know, when you go into someone's house, you're going to have a horrible mother-in-law. Okay? God knows what will happen. Every day the child is watching this, like, oh, my mother-in-law is going to be a horrible woman. And then if you find a good lady, the child is thinking, there must be something. She's hiding something. So our children are growing up with these values. In fact, in our school, when we were in school and all that, during the interval, you would speak about small things, about what happened in your house, who came home, who gave you what. Now our children are like, hey, Kanchanava ingedandi podichirukanga, kind of thing. So we want to move away from all this. I know you're laughing, but then it's happening, right? So we need to move with creativity again. A lot of material now is animated, because parents find it easier to keep children indoors and out of trouble than send them outdoor to play. Animated content, for example, reduces creativity. Let me tell you, when you say forest to a young child, the child is able to think about different things in its head. But the moment you animate that and show that the forest looks like this, the child can think of only that being the forest. Straight away, you push them into insanity, because they don't want to think of a forest in any other way. And then when somebody says, our forests are getting destroyed, they're wondering, why is it getting destroyed? Because in my animated CD, the forest looked very sound and secure. Right? Then you have the social skills. Most of us can tweet. Most of us can send SMS, but if you meet face to face, you're just looking here, looking there, and not sure how to communicate with each other. Right? Then you have reduced play. Children no longer play like we used to. Okay? No more creative play, no more kitchen sets. It's always a gun, wanting to shoot each other, kill each other, push each other off something, and then finally at the end of it, we say, our children are violent. I don't know where he learnt all this violence. Well, I know, and you know now, where they learnt all this violence. Okay, these are the toxins, and I say toxin because it's slowly changing the way they are thinking inside their head. And then there's no imaginative play. Children play only in rigid ways. And here I wish to use the gadgets that our children are using. See, now any average video game, and children start playing, it usually has an alien attack, or it has somebody who's escaped from somewhere, or a guy on a race bike or something like this. Okay? None of these are actually wholesome in any way. And then the child is either trying to kill, destroy, or break rules. And the faster and the better you break rules, the more you score. Okay, so if you're actually on the bike and you kick somebody like that, you get 200 points. Okay, I know you're laughing, but then that's a mental toxin, isn't it? So what you realize is, when I'm riding from here down to the AVRR, if somebody comes in the way, I can kick him. But you're teaching your children this. And then you say, our children are becoming violent. They don't know how to follow rules. Okay? And the worst thing that it does is problem solving. Children start a game And then they have a limited set of options. So there's no real problem solving. So you can choose between a gun, a knife, and probably a bazooka or something. Okay? And then you blow somebody's head off with that. And then you lose the ability to solve a problem. You think that violence is a solution for everything, when actually peaceful means are what we need to be looking for. Okay? And then the worst thing, you think term works, you restart. Life doesn't work like that. Okay? When you have problems, you need to look for real solutions, right? And then body image, we all don't need to say that I'm too fat, I'm too this, I'm too that, because all our models are anorexic people standing there and trying to tell us that you have to look a certain way if you have to be good, right? These are the mental toxins that we are repeatedly giving our children. And if the education system was not bad enough, we have these things that are corrupting them. So our definition of success comes to having more than being more of yourself. And that's where all of this starts from, and that's what we really need to change. And the insanity comes from the fact that we like to control a lot of the things coming to us. And the difference between need and greed is something our generation has to understand. Remember, what you need for your needs are fine, but for your greed to be fed, if you're going to destroy and to have mass models and mass productions in education, I don't see a better India coming up. So, let's say there's an anti-corruption drive that happens in Delhi. Everybody is liking it on Facebook. Everybody. There are like 1 million hits on Facebook. Everybody is happy. And then after that, after 3 days, no one even cares what happens. So there are no more TRPs for that. Okay? Then a rape victim comes along. And then everybody is like changing your photograph on Facebook to a black circle. Okay? And then after 4 weeks or 5 weeks, nobody even knows what happened to that girl. Okay? And then this is what we've been doing. And what we really need to do is, if we are not contributing in actual action, we're not really contributing at all. We're complicating the issue. And the two images I've used, let's consider community to be water. You need to be that drop of water with your values, with your innovation, with your strengths, contributing towards that society and staying there as yourself while working with like-minded people, than like a drop of ink that goes in there and becomes a happy part of the water, not really making a change, just like the likes on Facebook. In fact, there was a very nice picture of a child in Africa saying, "You think you clicking like is going to feed me for another day?" No. Okay? So, this is what really worked for me, and I'm just sharing it as an idea. First, create your vision. Believe me, no one has a created vision. I have my friend here with whom I worked with for the last 13 years. She's the silent part of whatever I do. Okay? Together, we've evolved a lot of our work. And what we really done was, we never really wanted to start schools. We never had this image of creative schools. We just wanted children to be happy. It was a very simple goal. And it slowly evolved into more and more information. Once we did that, we took calculated risks. We started taking action. The moment you take action, you get feedback. Immediately. That's what happens to anyone. You get feedback. If the feedback is positive, then you become more confident and you start improving on the process and you go back to taking action. If the feedback is negative to what you do, you go back again to the process. So that's the worst that can happen. Okay? Our system says only if you have more, you're successful. And so the moment we come to feedback and it's negative, we give up. And many a great idea was lost right there. Okay? And that's why I'm adding this slide. No matter how many resources you have, unless you know how to use those resources, and unless you actually use them, you will never be able to understand if they work. So success is the time you redefine your goals, and failure is the time that you redefine your methods. Because it's as simple as that. So, when I'm talking about change, we live in an India right now where no reformer is going to survive. Okay? They will be roped into one political party or the other. So, what can really happen is not a huge, large-scale reformation, but a transformation of itself. The moment I start transforming myself, I can reach 100 students today, right? And you could reach another 100, another 100, and that transformation of the self can only make that difference we need in our country. Because the economic disparity is becoming so large. So even if you become a great CEO of a huge company, 10 years from now, you will not have a workforce that has the skills to innovate, to drive change. And so in our schools, I've broken away from the cells and bells and also from the factory model. Every child has his or her own space to learn. And you can see there in a sanctuary, the children are having a look at what the elephant does in the forest. Okay. Otherwise, normally it would be E-L-E-T-H-A-N-T. And our children are not learning the E-L-E-T-H-A-N-T because they will learn how to spell. Anyway, they need to have more experiences. There you can see a child exploring something. That's pre-science. Before you learn science, you need to explore, to try. Then there's a child who's doing. All this is self-directed. You will notice that the teacher is only a facilitator. Because our children are more intelligent than we can ever imagine. Right? Then here you can see sculpture. Children are drawing it out. They're trying to understand the inscription and everything. We have a farmer here. Again, it's organic farming. Our children are taught organic farming on a regular basis, right from LKG onwards. Because it's important we start that early. Okay? Because once they think that it's normal, they will never think of anything different. Here again, children are looking at what is drip irrigation. They're looking at different forms of drip irrigation. Here we have children naturally playing with each other. Because I'll tell you one thing, 10 years from now, only in history books you will learn about human relationships. Mother's father is called mama. Okay, father's brother is called periyappa if he's older and chittappa if he's younger. So we are going towards those nuclear families now, and so it's very important for us to teach our children to play with each other, because if you want to fly fast, you can fly alone, you can cover a great distance. But if you want to fly towards reformation, you need to fly together. And then of course these are experiments. Here I talked about creativity. A small piece of plastic can become a camera for a child. You don't need to buy a digital camera. And these are the village schools and slum schools. My work is not limited to all these expensive schools, but also to a lot of village schools and slums. Don't let them filter your creativity. Look for resources. Thank you so much.